Hey you, welcome to chapter 11 of my Dead Space 2 no damage playthrough on Zealot difficulty. I am Stud Doogie. In the previous chapter we left off with Strauss attacking Ellie. It seemed like he was about to do some serious damage to her. We don't know what the situation is at this point in the story, but you and I already know what it is, because my expectation of course is that you've played the game so you know what's going on. And, you know, there's a couple of important story beats I want to talk about in this particular chapter. But before we do that, this is going to be my favorite kill in the game that's coming up. Because I'm going to be shooting like a scrub, but I'm going to redeem myself by getting a triple. I think this is the only triple I've gotten in this game. So, check it out. Here it comes. So I'm supposed to hit this dude. Totally whiffed that shot, so that's two guys right there. There's the one up top, so there's a total of three of them. Okay, so he's dead. I'll check this out. So there are two left. Here comes the triple. Slow him down. This guy is peeking, hiding, blow up the baby. That's a triple. My favorite kill of the game. Very, very proud of myself. Redeemed myself after all that missing of the shots. I've been playing like a scrub. Sometimes you're on, sometimes you're not. What else? One of the benefits of playing a solo game instead of a PvP game is you don't let your team down or anything like that when you're playing against the computer versus playing against other people. So here's Strauss. Okay, so there's a big story beat that underlies what we're hearing now that I thought was a sort of failure of imagination, I think, in the telling of the story. And I'm going to get into it when we get to it. You know what? No, I'm going to talk about it now. I'm going to talk about it after this next section is going to come up, because I want you guys to understand the decision that I make when we finally catch up with Strauss. So we're going to be going into probably one of my favorite zones for fights, because it seems like it's like the never-ending monster zone. Like every time you think you've cleared all the enemies, more spawn. So it's a really kind of fun fight. It was a terrifying fight the first time, because like, Jesus Christ, when is this going to be over? They just keep coming. And it's dark. Like this first enemy we're going to come up against, you can't even see him. And that's my fault primarily, because I do have my settings, my brightness turned down so low. So we're going to stock up on some ammo here, and we're going to enter this room. Now you're going to see me walk forward and then walk backwards. And the reason for that is the enemy spawns are randomized, such that sometimes the demon babies spawn. And the demon babies, what I'm talking about, is the ones that are little babies that have the three tendrils that spring out of their back and shoot at you. So the demon baby spawns on top of the railing, or climbs up on top of the railing and will jump on your face if you're standing there. Other times it does not. So that's me running forward and backwards trying to trigger the spawn, but in this instance it was not. Look at this guy. You couldn't see him across the way. So that's two kills or two enemies. This dude definitely want to stasis him so we can back up so we don't get hit by that AoE. And I hadn't played this enough to know exactly how many are spawning. Plus it changes. So what you're going to see here is I'm slowing down because I'm hoping the other guy is going to come around the other side. But he did not. And he did not because of how far out I was. I should have been closer, which would have forced him to approach. There he goes. So there's a way to work it where you stasis the sack guy and then get a twofer by blowing up the puker. The chocolate, the crispy puker, because he's the burnt variant, which is more dangerous and more fast moving. So you think it's over, there's another one. Now I'm expecting, there it goes, demon baby, done. So you think it's over, but no, there's more. So This one waits until you open the locker to get the battery out, but I didn't know that at the time. Fucker. Here he comes now. And then there's one on the stairs. You could hear him, but we couldn't see him. All right. I'm going to go get my loots. That's another one. It just never ends. They just keep coming. Which is a lot of fun once you kind of know that's what is going on. But for a first playthrough, it's kind of daunting, to be honest. Or it was. Because you don't know what is it. What sound means they're there or whatever, you know? So this is a setup for a potential kill. I didn't end up needing to use... Look at that. The fucker just showed up. Like, I didn't even remember that it was there and I'm doing the post commentary. So this is a really tense zone because of the fact that they just keep coming. They keep coming. I'm running up the stairs to get my loot. I really need to be less loot focused. My playthroughs would be a lot shorter if I didn't spend so much time stomping stuff and getting all my loot, but I am who I am. And that's why you love me. So anyway, once we put this battery in here, swap the batteries out, there's going to be another set of spawns that begin the cycle anew. Alright, here we go. So, that was supposed to be about slowing him down, but I just shot him instead of even bothering with the stasis. Got a twofer. That was an accident. I meant to slow him down, but I hit him on his sack and it blew him up. So, blew both of them up. Now, I'm expecting another sack guy, but another one's not going to spawn, at least not in this playthrough. It didn't spawn. Alright, so you think it's over. You think you've killed all the things. Nope. 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 Now the reason I stasised him because I wanted to move past him, because if I stayed on that stairway dealing with him, the puker who comes up behind would have got a clear shot at me. So I stasised him so I could rotate and avoid the pukers, because remember, this is a no damage run. Get some loot. I mean, at this stage in the game, I really don't need to pick all this stuff up, but what can I say? I'm trying to get better at it. Like, it's hauling ass. Now, nothing spawns behind us, but I was checking. And that's one of the things I do with these camera rotations when I'm reloading. Is I'll rotate the camera just to make sure there's nothing behind me. So that's it. I think. I don't remember. It's been a while since I recorded this. I think this is it. I think that was the last one. Yeah, it is. Okay, so now that's over, let's talk about the story beat that I want to talk about. So, Strauss has become a legitimate threat. And from a story's perspective, that's kind of surprising. There you are, Isaac. We've been waiting for you. You know, he looks malicious. I'm sorry, Ellie. He took her eye. That's some fucked up shit. So the fact that he went from being our friend to being what we'd assume to be a coward to being a legitimate threat all under our noses without us sort of fully noticing it, I think that's pretty good storytelling. Pretty good execution or the sort of development, character development. Alright, so there's that. But now here comes the part that's the story problem. We're going to face him when we go back into the space station, when we're done with all this stuff. By the way, I hate this. I hate the fact that the reticle is on the enemy, but I'm shooting the metal post because there's an invisible extension to the object that we're looking at. Why can't they make games that are precise, right? If the reticle is on the target, then that's what should happen. It shouldn't be shooting the sign. That same shit happens in Dead Space 3, and it just annoys the crap out of me. Anyway, so when we go back inside, we're going to face off against Strauss. And the way the fight goes down is we ultimately kill Strauss. Now, in my first playthrough, that made absolutely no sense to me for a couple reasons. The first reason was the way the fight went down. And we'll talk about that first reason in more detail when we get to the fight. The second reason is at the point that the fight goes down, we still don't know how to destroy the marker. And this entire story arc up to this point has been about stabilizing Strauss, protecting Strauss, so Strauss could tell us or show us or teach us how to destroy the marker. So why in the name of the storytelling gods would they, before the end of the thing, have us kill Strauss? Now, we get the answer to that a few moments after we kill him, but in that moment, I was like, this is some bullshit. Now, I mean, that's just like a big freaking plot hole. And then there's the detail of the fight itself. There's one specific detail of the fight that annoys the crap out of me. But I can see a cheesy excuse why they did it that way. I just still think it's crap. Okay, so that was my first playthrough. Like, that disappointment in how they dealt with the Strauss thing, the failure as a storytelling mechanic of us killing him. But in second and subsequent playthroughs, I was livid that he hurt Ellie. And when I fight him, you're gonna see what I did. Like, I fucked his shit up. Like, you don't put your hands on Ellie, son. Like, that's not allowed. Like, you needed to die. You needed to fucking die. You took her eye. Now, this is overkill. There's one worm. And I'm about to blow his ass up. This is complete overkill for that worm. Oh, man, that's satisfying. I'm going to get my loot. Suck it. Blow your ass up, too. There's this other bit that I find absolutely hilarious that's coming up next. Now, the reason I rotate right behind that rock is because when his bodily fluids can do harm to you. Therefore, it's useful to make sure you have some space between you and it so as not to get unnecessarily damaged. Dude trying to sneak up on something, I'm going to pay for it. So, here comes this beat that cracks me the hell up. So, we got two dudes about to drop down in front of us making all sorts of noise. Alright, here comes homeboy. I'm being uber cautious. Plus, I like hitting him with this, which is ridiculous that can knock him down. And check homeboy out. Doop 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 doop. Like, he's trying to sneak over somebody, you know what I mean? He ain't fooling nobody, son. It's so weird that in, you know, subsequent playthroughs, when you're doing New Game Plus and you have everything, to not go through these node doors when they were so crucial to our progress in the first and second playthroughs before we had everything, you know. So I'm still opening this stuff up, but you know, like I did a New Game Plus playthrough after I made this video, and it was just so weird to remember to run past this stuff because none of it matters anymore. Okay, so here comes the Strauss thing. And here's a bit in the fight, a moment in the fight that makes freaking no sense to me. So Strauss is coming at us with a screwdriver. trying to take out our eye, and we take her freaking helmet off. What the? Look, he actually hits us in the face with it, and we're protected by our mask. So what do? We take it off. How stupid is that? Like, the first time, I'm like, don't kill him, don't kill him, don't kill him. And then when he did that, I was like, how stupid is that? But this now, fucking take your head off. I'm going to stomp the shit out of you. How dare you take Ellie's eye? Fucker. I'm sorry. You don't fuck with Ellie, man. So now, if you had run through to that door the first time around, instead of standing around to have those enemies spawn, they would have spawned, and that was my expectation. I was waiting for at least a puker to spawn, but we didn't have to deal with that because we killed everything our first time through. Okay, now this is going to be an example story-wise of where Isaac is kind of losing his grip, But he does come to a very important resolution that is central. Listen to this bit. He blames his psychosis. I'm calling the alien presence in his mind his psychosis. She made him kill Strauss. Nobody made you kill Strauss, dude. That was you. And for us, the player, my rationalization is that I killed you because you fucked with Ellie. That is the sole reason. Like, I'm willing to let the marker survive to get vengeance for hurting Ellie. Well, this is one of my favorite but weird fights, because things go flying that's not supposed to go flying. I just like the cramped space of it. You know what I mean? There's just zero room for mistakes here. Especially if you're doing a no damage run, so... And this is one of the few places that I use stasis regularly, because this is a no damage run. Otherwise, I do like the don't miss the shot challenge of it. But I do use some stasis as a buffer, primarily because the closer the enemy is to you when you're using the javelin, there's a probability, there's a chance that you'll shoot through them instead of shooting them. So I use it to maintain that distance. So that's where you see me maintaining the distance right there. Because if he gets too much closer, the round might go through him instead of actually hitting him. And there he goes flying, which is weird. See? We're almost to the top. I don't know how that didn't hit. Well, I guess it did hit. You just got blown the half up. Alright, we're getting close to the end of this chapter. So here we're going to get an answer to the question that I thought should have been dropped, is how does he destroy the marker now that Strauss is dead? See, we all need a purpose. Step four. That's it. Acceptance. Now you're ready to finish this. Yep. So, yeah, makes no real sense to me. So, I'm gonna go through the door here to trigger the title for the next chapter, and then come back and save. But that's the end of this chapter. I would like to thank you for watching. I appreciate that, whoever you are, who leaves a like on my video. That's very generous of you. I appreciate it. So I'll see you in the next one. I'm going to cut it off here. The video will be ending soon. Bye-bye now.